Welcome to Go for the Goal. Afghanistan and Pakistan have been struggling to obtain a sustainable peace for more than a decade. After the Peshawar school attack, Pakistan for the first time seemed determined towards fighting Taliban. And as the National Unity Government took over in Afghanistan, a new era of relationship between the two countries started. Major steps are taken. The Afghan government is reportedly at the Taliban's doorstep for a peace deal. Top Pakistani military leaders have visited Kabul more than four times in the past 150 days. Intelligence cooperation is at unprecedented level, and Afghan cadets are dispatched to Pakistan military schools. A strong initiative by both governments at the same time is criticized by many, given that ISIS is rising in the region, India is ignored, and Pakistan's sincerity is questioned. In the presence of all obstacles, how sustainable the situation is, what measures have to be taken to ensure a productive process, what outcome this new phase of Afghan-Pakistan relationship will have. In today's program, Tullow News joins Pakistan's Geo News to discuss some of the questions. On the Afghan panel here in Kabul, I'm joined by Wahid Omar, a former aide and a spokesperson to President Hamid Karzai, Dr. Dawood Muradian, Director of Afghanistan's Institute of Strategic Studies, and last but not least, former Deputy Foreign Minister, Mr. Javed Lodin. Now back to Pakistan.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this part of the show. We are very blessed in the sense that we have a great panel. We've got students from three different universities. What lies between the borders? And what lies between the borders is a lot of history, a lot of friction, a lot of tension, but a great deal of potential for cooperation. And that's what we're here to explore, which way the two countries are going to move forward. And of course, no one is more qualified to reflect on at least many of these aspects than Engineer Khurram Dastagir Khan, who's a sitting Federal Minister for Commerce and looking after the parliamentary business of Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and somebody who has a deep interest and seeing cooperation prevail. Khurram Saab, thank you very much for being with us. Next to him is Ms. Sherry Rahman, who is Chairperson Jinnah Institute, an institute that has come up as a platform of great strategic thinking, involved in two-track diplomacy in a deep way with India, and also has been hosting many insightful discussions on this very topic that we have for the show today. She's also Pakistan's former ambassador to the US and was a federal minister for information in the previous regime. Thank you very much for being with us. And last but not least, Ambassador Ali Sarwar Naqvi, who heads another upcoming and a great institute. He's executive director for Center for International Strategic Studies. He's a former ambassador to the UN, Paris, Brussels, and Washington, D.C. Ambassador Sub, thank you very much. And let me not forget to thank the universities that have sent their students here, Namal University, Bahrain University, and Preston University. We would now go back to Kabul and request Lutfullah to get the opening statements from their panelists and then come back to Islamabad and have a response from the from our panel.
Thank you, Talat. I would like to start with Wahid. What has changed in the Afghanistan-Pakistan relationship in the past 150 days?
On the general relations between Afghanistan and Pakistan, I think we have not done very well over the past 13 years. And the reason why people on both sides suffer so much, and the reason why we're still, actually 13 years on, we're still talking about the peace process with Pakistan's involvement, is that we have wasted a lot of time. In Pakistan in particular, there is a democratic government for domestic reasons. But then when it comes to relations with Afghanistan or relations with India or many other countries, then we're dealing with a military regime. There has been a lot of efforts by the civil society, by the media, by the parliamentarians, by the think tanks to try to improve people's to people's relations. Mm-hmm. But the core issue, which is political relations between the two countries, remains there, and that is I think we'll have to discuss later on as we go on talking about the peace process.
Dr. Samuradian, the head of the Pakistani army and the head of the ISI have visited Kabul four times, and that is unprecedented. Are we dealing with the right people in Pakistan now, and are you optimistic?
I think the question is that one of the main challenge in relationship between Afghanistan and Pakistan, as was alluded with Mr. Omar, the incompatibility between the partners in Afghanistan and in Pakistan. We are a fairly democratic states, and the civilian authority has the final say in the matter of the national security issue. Whereas in Pakistan, unfortunately, is a security state. So on one hand, we have a democratic Kabul dealing with a security Pakistan. And there are fundamental differences between a democratic mindset and a security mindset. For a democratic mindset, that also in Pakistan, in civilian government, is theirs. They want to serve the interests of the people. Whereas in the security statement, state and security establishment, they look from the prism of security. And if you look at from the prism of security, everyone has two identity. Either he or she is a threat or is as a leverage here. And the problem with Afghanistan, Pakistan has been that the Pakistani military establishment has looked at Afghanistan either as a threat or as a leverage for Pakistani military establishment geostrategic game in the region.
Minister Ludin, you've been in the government, and but now, given the fact that we know that who we deal with in Pakistan, but aren't we dealing with the right people? Are the Pakistani leaders in the establishment in particular aren't very serious about some sort of a settlement?
I believe they are, and I hope that they are. I mean, we Afghans are very deeply suspicious of the intentions of Pakistan, and I hate to see this discussion today turning into a rather negative back and forth discussion, because we are at the what seems to be a very promising effort to try to finally bring the peace process to some sort of fruition. In the coming weeks, we're going to see some positive outcomes on that, I hope. And we shouldn't really put that under any negative light. However, the reality is that Afghans, I think they can be, they are justifiably very skeptical. Frankly, it's not a question of only the past government or the past 13 years. Historically, you go back in the living memory of people who are alive today, the two countries have hardly enjoyed a cordial, friendly relationship. And this is really a very, very negative, very unfortunate reality. And the governments right now, whether the government of President Ghani in Afghanistan or the government in Pakistan, have an opportunity to change that historic reality. I think there is, I mean, what really has changed, to go back a little bit to your earlier question, I mean, things in Afghanistan changed at the surface. I mean, there's a new government, but it's essentially a continuity of the establishment here, as was alluded by my colleagues. We've also seen a number of other strategic calculations from the point of view of Pakistan in the region that have changed. The United States has remained committed, NATO and others are there, and the region, regional as well as domestic consensus for the peace process has remained, and it hasn't changed a bit. What we hope has changed is a calculation in Pakistan.
Things have changed here in Kabul, and we hope things have changed in Pakistan. There's a moment of opportunity that we have to grasp, but there are challenges, of course, that the two countries need to tackle. Going back to you, Talat, to take your opening remarks from your panel.
Thank you very much, Lutfullah. Enjoyed being assessed out of Kabul. Kabul did share a perspective, one dimension of the perspective about Pakistan. It's an important starting point. Without much ado, let me go to Ms. Sheri Rahman and get her opening statement on what has been said, or standalone kind of a statement. Go ahead, Ms. Sheri.
There's a change in the rhetoric and the talk, as well as strategic messaging from Afghanistan. We welcome it. We think that President Ghani is actually sincere in his efforts. We do want to take him at face value. There is a lot of reason for us to also be deconstructing this as a trust issue. But I think one of the ways of going forward between countries with a history of unfortunate baggage or vexed baggage that we're seeing between us is to really pin down a few nodes that are appearing as strategic hope. I do see that. So it's hope resurgent from both countries. Why from Pakistan? Well, I think that change has been not particularly slow in the happening. It's not recent either. It's a country that is able to make its own decisions. We have obviously executive centers of power. There is a great, there's much more distribution of power than there was, say, 7-8 years ago. Our courts are very active, in fact, extremely proactive. Our media is a key contender and a very robust contender in a daily town hall engagement on our television shows, which refracts democracy and its discontents, which are many all the time, to the people of Pakistan and back. We are hearing about the military and the ISI, which will operationalize the security plan if indeed there is a constructive one. But honestly, I think the big change that needs to be acknowledged by our friends and will actually help them in the future in terms of calibrating Pakistan's plans, aims, the limits to Pakistani power, strategic power with those that they can broker peace with, as well as where Pakistan wants to take the peace process. It wants to take the peace process forward because 6-7 years ago, there was a calculation that we want to clearly move on from what used to be strategic, we used to treat Afghanistan as our strategic backyard. And what we're seeing today is a detritus of that dynamic that was fairly toxic, and it started from the Zia years and the Afghan Jihad years, and we don't need to recapitulate history for our young people.
That's a fair point in terms of capturing the spirit of times, as it were, in Pakistan, in terms of the fundamental changes that have taken place in outlook as well as substance. Khurram Dastagir Saab, have your say, please.
I think we are in the midst of a moment of rare opportunity. What changed first was Pakistan. And some years ago, and correctly pointed out, there developed in Pakistan a political consensus that we are going to now establish our relations with Afghanistan on basis of respect for each other's mutual sovereignty that exists, and also reciprocity. So this mutual respect for each other's sovereignty was the key. And it was, I think, articulated, and this consensus as it developed was articulated by then he was not the Prime Minister, Nawaz Sharif, in the run-up to the elections in 2013, in which he clearly said that Pakistan respects the wishes of the Afghan people, and therefore Pakistan will not interfere in any way in the Afghan election. And when the people of Pakistan elected our party into power, we proved that with our actions, in which we were very fair, neutral, as any other country who is observing the other country's elections. And we ensured that we talked to all sides. We played no favorites. We have been accused in the past of intervening, but we did not intervene at all. And it was this change that occurred in Pakistan first, which I believe was reflected eventually by the way the people of Afghanistan voted. And the new government that has come in, now that government is much more positive, because ultimately I think the calculation in Pakistan, which was made a few years ago, and now was made in Afghanistan last year, is that the dividends of cooperation are much greater than whatever benefits hostilities might bring. So that calculation, or you can flip it in fact, that the dangers of non-cooperation are much more toxic than cooperation. So that understanding on which basis now both countries are operating, we have this really a wonderful moment in which we can establish our ties. There are clear issues of, I think, very high on the agenda of securing, regulating, and facilitating how the border operates between the two countries, how the trade operates between the two countries, and of course, I want to mention this, it's very important, is for Pakistan's regional connection through Afghanistan to Central Asia, through many ways, through trade, through energy connectivity, through investments. I think there's a great opportunity and which we should be very careful not to lose and capitalize on the fullest.
Ambassador Naqvi, since you've worked so much on the Pak-Afghan border, apart from other issues, let me hear your thoughts on this.
I was listening to what was being said from Kabul, and you see, I found that the strategic, that's my immediate reaction, I felt that the strategic community in Kabul, in Afghanistan, is a little behind times. And why? Because talking about Pakistan as a security state driven by the security establishment and everything else falling in place accordingly is taking a very simplistic view of Pakistan and as to what has evolved over the years. And I have a feeling also that the government in Kabul, the Afghan government under President Ashraf Ghani, is more attuned with what's happening now, because I know I have myself had the privilege of meeting President Ashraf Ghani when he was at the World Bank and I was in our embassy in Washington, and I found him to be a very, very balanced person who is aware of the world, who has a very sharp perception of our regional problems and everything. So we have to look at what our problems are. Let's not label each other. That's not a good idea. We have to look at what our problems are. And I think one of our basic problems is border management, where, you know, the borders allow terrorism and smuggling and crime and all kinds of negatives to flourish. And that is something that we have to stop, and for that we have to work together, which will lead to economic cooperation and which would lead to better relations.
Thank you very much. Let me take a break. We need to turn swords into plowshares. That's how we want to leave it when I take a break. And then I expect my co-host Lutfullah to start out of Kabul after the break.
Welcome back. We heard from Pakistan a few main comments. One was that are we really behind time on our perception of Pakistan and how politics work there? Second is the question is why the Pakistani government and establishment should really think that there is a change in Kabul. So I would like to take your reaction to the comments and plus if you can highlight to the two main points.
Well, I think we are not behind time, but we are rather behind the level of trust that would drive us to be as optimistic as our Pakistani friends are. Yes, the blame game is very repetitive. The blame game is very, you know, boring. In the meantime, you know, drawing rosy pictures of the situations is as boring and as repetitive. We have spent all the past, since 2006 and 7, since the Taliban re-emerged and all that, we have spent a lot of time in trying to tell each other, look, the situation is changing, we are coming to, you know, the actual, we are realizing the reality, we are both suffering and all that. But I've seen it with my eyes that things have not changed so much. Yes, there is a honeymoon of relations right now between President Ghani's government and the Pakistani government, as was a honeymoon of relations between President Zardari and President Karzai's governments when President Zardari came in. The Pakistanis said, now we have, General Musharraf is gone, we have a democratic government, President Karzai understands the situation, so we are going to solve this situation. We are once again back into that same vicious circle. Back in 2011, that was when President Zardari and President Karzai enjoyed the best relationship. Prime Minister Gilani was the Prime Minister of Pakistan. And then Pakistan was in a lot worse situation than it is right now. The Taliban had come very close to Islamabad. They had actually intruded some very sensitive military installations. And the Pakistani government was really, you know, at risk and was very, you know, annoyed with the situation. So a message came to President Karzai, the Pakistani government wants to come in, they really want to talk, we are ready for peace, let's do something about it. And they came in. At that very sensitively difficult time, which I don't think Pakistan is now at that kind of difficulty, Prime Minister Gilani, the Chief of Army Staff, Mr. Kayani, Mr. Pasha, the Chief of ISI, all of them came and they sat down and they actually developed a very nice speech for Prime Minister Gilani that he had to read. And that speech came as a surprise for us because our view was that there is goodwill, Pakistan is in trouble, so are we in trouble. Pakistan really is honest in trying to deal with us, so let's talk. And that speech turned into a list of demands that Pakistan put forward.
But that was past,
we want a
right?
friendly.
But
I know. But what I'm going to tell you is nothing has changed for good since 2011. I think it's a honeymoon for Dr. Ghani and Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif or Mr. Sharif, the Chief of Army Staff. This honeymoon is going to be over. There will be a month of April, and there will be a fighting season, and then the peace that I call the winter peace will turn into, unfortunately, a spring war season.
Dr. Mouradian, President Ghani domestically has been criticized for being very pro-Pakistan in the past few months, and apparently the Pakistani government and the establishment have welcomed the initiatives by Kabul and President Ghani in particular. Are you not witnessing this change in Kabul, which should be convincing for the Pakistanis? Don't you think that we have done enough for Islamabad to realize that we are a better partner than some of the groups, you know, who are seeking shelters across the border?
I think I have to say a number of issues. One is that in Afghanistan, there is no war constituency. Almost all of us, we want peace in Afghanistan. That is an absolute national consensus in Afghanistan, and all Afghans would support any process, any initiative that brings peace to Afghanistan. And also, in that context, there is no per se anti-Pakistani constituency in Afghanistan. We all want to have a good neighborly relationship with Pakistan. On that principle, we all support the Afghan National Unity Government's initiative to engage with Pakistan's and to help improve bilateral relationship. But there are two constituencies in Afghanistan. The first constituency is the skeptical constituency. And those constituencies say that we have been there before. I mean, Mr. Omar gave just an example of a very recent initiative by Kabul that we thought that it was there is a new Islamabad, but in less than a year, we were disappointed here. The second constituency is that they're asking what price. We want peace, but the peace has to have the right price. And there are three reservations on three concerns. One is on the constitutionalism in Afghanistan. If peace process with Pakistan would mean re-Talibanization of part of Afghan politics, then Afghan would not accept that kind of peace that would reintroduce Talibanization into Afghan society, yes. The second reservation is that if peace means Afghanistan lose its independence in foreign policy. And the fact that this temptation is there that a good relationship with Pakistan has to be at the expense of a severing our ties with Delhi, that price we are not going to pay here. And the third reservation is that if peace means that to change the balance of the internal politics in Afghanistan, that also will not be accepted. I was in Pakistan, just came back 2 days ago, and I have a list of that I compare with my previous visit to Pakistan when President Karzai was the president of Afghanistan. And I compare what was Pakistan then and what was Pakistan then. And I'm sorry to say that nothing has changed on the ground. Mm. Afghan TV is still not acceptable in Pakistan. Afghan mobile are still barred in Pakistan. We agreed 48 agreements with Pakistan for economic and trade and transit relationship, and neither of them has been implemented. The Taliban are fearing moving in Kuwait, in Karachi, in Peshawar here. So really, from Kabul side, Kabul has given whatever it can, but that has not been reciprocated by Pakistan. And that lack of reciprocity has reinforced the suspicion in Kabul that business is as usual as far as Pakistan is concerned.
There is no war constituency here, and there is no anti-Pakistani constituency here. We have done our part of the deal, and it's for Pakistan now to deliver. So, Talat, back to you to take some of the remarks, and then we're coming back to Minister Ludin.
Let me go to my panelists and ask them to reflect on what is being said there. Obviously, it's unidimensional view, one type of view. It's preconditioning peace, that, you know, if there must be peace, then you need to sort of do these two or three things. And then there's also a cynical constituency in Pakistan which says that, really, why talk to Kabul? Talk to Washington. You know, if you were to really make things happen in Afghanistan, don't talk to Kabul, talk to Washington. Go ahead.
A conscious, deliberate effort to inject economic cooperation into the relationship equation, which has been missing. And there is agreement between the two governments that we are going to deliberately inject this economic cooperation issues. So therefore, we are also now moving ahead with the positivity that exists in Afghanistan on a transit trade agreement, we hope, with Central Asian countries. But also, Pakistan is reciprocating to the Afghan peace overtures by offering now a vast set of facilitations at our ports for Afghan goods. And once that, I think, comes into place anytime in the next few weeks, there will be a clear change in how things move through Pakistan for Afghanistan. Because again, as I said, the security quagmire has been there for so many years. We have not stepped out of it. Here, we are essentially using the rope of economic cooperation to climb out of that quagmire and say, okay, we are going to cooperate economically. Pakistan is going to rebuild its ports on Torkham and Chaman. We want to formalize, as I said, regulate, also facilitate the movement of people and goods across our borders. And through this, already there is enough people to pay people connection. People travel all the time. But to formalization of this relation, I repeat, on the basis of respect for each other's sovereignty, is very much now established in Pakistan, and the civilian elected governments have taken the lead in this.
Sherry, we don't seem to be getting the message across to Kabul with all the positivity that Minister Saab has spoken about.
I think we need to move beyond intellectual stalemating and a frozen discourse. I mean, this is not, you know, a salad that can be stuck in aspic. It's got to move on. And what I'm excited about is the messaging from, at least from the government in Kabul. President Ghani is most impressive in his vision of how the circles of change will move. He sees things as he sees events, not necessarily as episodic, but as part of a process. He sees them as sequential. That is precisely how we see them, and we see them as reciprocal. Burden share is essentially how grown-ups talk to each other in you know, my world. And I'm looking at the new Kabul wanting to do that. Let's talk about our anxieties about change and how we're doing a bad job of mapping change in each other's countries, gentlemen. We're doing a not so bad job of understanding the opportunity. And I think our governments are doing a better job, including our militaries, of leveling up on delivering and understanding and cashing in on the opportunity. What does cashing in mean? It means, number one, not to expect one country to deliver wholly. Let's not make this about a winter of our discontent. The spring will clearly see some fighting in Afghanistan. We talk about people who don't process change well in Pakistan as those who live in denialistan. Let's not be like that. Let's understand that there are problems on the ground.
I think we have some instant feedback from Kabul. Yeah. They want to intervene.
There are problems on the ground, and we need to address those together.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, go ahead, Lutfullah. get your point of view across, and we want to involve the audience as well. Go ahead.
All right. I would like to go to Minister Ludin to some of the points mentioned that, you know, we have to basically map the change. Are we really behind? Do we really don't see the change in Pakistan, and they have a problem seeing the change here?
Well, I'm happy. I'm encouraged that the Pakistani government, but also the society and the respective panelists there reflected that, are appreciating the positive messages that have, or the positive notes from the Afghan government so far. But they have to realize that no government in Afghanistan can sustain that for a very long time. This government has taken a huge gamble. We have not yet seen any results on the ground. And let's be very clear, results in Afghanistan do not mean continued endless rhetoric about positive cooperation on the economic side. And even I think I'm actually a bit misled by the emphasis from Pakistan on border management and all the rest of it. Actually, the show in Pakistan is unhelpfully titled something about borders. This is not about borders. This is about very, very practical, concrete cooperation, something that we have asked Pakistan for many, many years, and that's on the peace process. Taliban do not necessarily have the same, pose the same level of threat that they did a number of years ago to us. We are not scared. Taliban, actually, they weren't able to score any military victory in the past winter offensive. So it's not that we are totally helpless in begging Pakistan for help like we did a number of years ago. We were really helpless. But it would be actually an amazing start for Pakistan and Afghanistan to finally turn a page and make this very concrete project, which is the peace process, as a start. Confidence building measures have, essentially has been really the past 6 months, that's what have happened. And a lot of people in Afghanistan are uneasy about President Ashraf Ghani's steps, some of the measures, and I don't have
to. What do we want
have to,
from them? We wanted them to surrender the Taliban. Is the peace process a top priority for us?
Totally.
Or as they said, we can make it more economic centric. What do we want as the number one priority?
You see, as two neighbors, you know, you name it, anything that you can possibly think of will be a subject of cooperation and coexistence between the two countries. And but a lot of times that's used in order to distract from the real issue. The real issue in Afghanistan, the time-sensitive issue, is to do it with a very, very practical objective, and that is to either deliver Mullah Omar, the Quetta Shura, the Taliban in general that are based in Pakistan, to the negotiating table, and do that in a way that helps the interest of the region, the interest of global security. The global security is changing, and we have to really keep up with time in that sense, practically. And if there is any reason where the peace process, the direct negotiations with the Taliban cannot start in the next few weeks, then we have to see military operations in Quetta and Karachi and Peshawar and getting those Taliban's arrested, the Taliban leaders arrested. This is a very time-sensitive issue as well. As I said, I think President Ghani, it's not one of those things that would take months and years.
The point about border management is important for a whole variety of reasons. And what the minister said about the Quetta Shura or Mullah Omar or whatever, this is all a function of bad border management. We are two neighboring countries, we must have proper border management. The case of US and Mexico is a problem border. The case of US and Canada is a well-managed border. So we have to look at these international examples. Pakistan and Afghanistan have to look at how to manage their border, their common border, properly. And that is something that the new Afghan government has indicated that they are willing to do that.
Internal reconciliation process in Afghanistan is for it is an internal process.
I'll go.
We are a facilitator to the process. And to expect that Pakistan will deliver peace in Afghanistan we can be very easily accused of intervening in another sovereign country.
Absolutely.
So this acceptance that Afghanistan is a sovereign country, their internal reconciliation is internal. We are just facilitators of the process, mm-hmm. and we will step into the process as much as our Afghan brethren and the Afghan government wishes us to.
Yes.
Otherwise, it's up for them to decide what kind of help they need.
Okay.
Pakistan cannot deliver.
Absolutely, and I'll endorse that. It has to be, we have to be very clear that we're not interfering, playing ducks and drakes. We only get involved on the specific ask of Kabul officially, as defined by a roadmap between Pakistan, well, during the last few years it's been Pakistan, Afghanistan and the United States. We've always in a trilat to discuss these this roadmap. I don't know what is the level of disengagement or terms of disengagement after the bilateral security agreement and the status of forces agreement with the United States and their 10,000 forces still in the country and a process of transition. I think this is a fragile but important moment. We should all work towards a clearly defined ask from Kabul in what Kabul wants. And that is the limit of Pakistani engagement in the peace process, which to my mind is going to be fraught with challenges. But I think talking to each other is the first task.
Ms. Omar, Taliban is there to facilitate, not to deliver. Is that enough for us? Do we want a facilitation or we want a delivery?
Facilitation, I think, I remember back in 2011, a statement by General Kayani in one of the meetings. General Kayani said, look, if you want us to deliver Taliban to you and bring them on the table, you are exaggerating, overestimating our power, because we no longer enjoy that kind of power over Pakistan, and I think that continues to be the situation. I do not think, personally, that Pakistan has the kind of leverage to bring all the Taliban on the negotiation table. I think they are bluffing, in a way they are bluffing. And second, I don't think there is an organized group with one or two leaders called the Taliban. Mm-hmm. Taliban is a network of criminals, drug lords, plus terrorists, plus ideologues who have no leadership per se. Mm-hmm. You could actually, what Pakistan could obtain from what's going on at the moment, the leverage, they will actually bring some people to sit with the Afghan government, to make peace with the Afghan government, and then Pakistan would say, look, the leadership of Taliban is no longer in Pakistan, they have made peace with Afghanistan, and everything else is Afghanistan's internal issue, as it was said, that internal reconciliation is the issue. I think they want to make it an internal reconciliation issue for us so that we would never ever claim the sanctuaries or the support that Pakistan is giving the Pakistani leadership.
I heard some endorsement of your comments on the other side, but I think now it's time to go to the audience here. I see a post 9/11 generation of Afghans in the room who have heard Pakistan being involved in most of the negative developments in this country for the past 13 years. So if there is any question to be asked from the Pakistani side, please, you ma'am.
Thank you so much. Respect to the panel in Pakistan, I want to be so optimistic and then ignore that, okay, they will be committed to what they claim this time. I want to ask, okay, if this time your interest is lies in the peace talks and you Pakistani government to want to take it forward, I want to say how they make sure that to address or create a platform where we have in this side, Afghan government have the consent and commitment of both military regime and the elected democratic state in this process.
Okay. One more question.
Don't you think that Pakistan should change a bureaucratic strategy that dushman ka dushman dost hota hai? Whenever the clashes of India and Pakistan increases, so the Pakistan were always bringing the enmity of India and Pakistan in a table of negotiation, in a table of clashes. So don't you think that Pakistan should solve the issue of the bureaucratic strategy that I have mentioned?
The first question was military and political government being on the same page. The other is Pakistan bringing in the third dimension, the Indian dimension, onto the table of negotiations with Kabul.
As far as Afghanistan is concerned, as I understand it, the military and the good news is that the military and the civilian elected governments, both governments, and the last one and this one are all on the same page. So there is a mainstream consensus in moving forward. The no favorites in Afghanistan is also pivotal to this project of change in our policy, strategic shift, and very quickly. So I think that's one of the things that we need to, I think what we also need to speak to is that we kept hearing from Afghanistan, and we continue to hear that, you know, somebody just said, is Pakistan bluffing? Listen carefully. We are signaling very critical changes from Bamiyan to today, when those wonderful statues were destroyed and you know, nobody could do anything to stop that. We have come a long way. I won't say baby. We have come a long way. We understand that there are limits to power, exercise of sovereignty and you know, spaces ungovernable remain on both sides of the border. There are tough, why do you think this border is an issue? It has become an easy freeway for both of us when we are trying to create, you know, sanctify both sides of the border. And these are two countries. If you're two countries, you have a border. There are 235 entry points across which free traffic is taking place. And now when Pakistan has been clamping down since that SWAT thing that was mentioned by one of your able interlocutors, since the TTP had tried to advance from SWAT, Pakistan has been undergoing several levels of escalated military operations. And in this task, we need for that border to be managed and secure, so our bad guys are not sanctuaried.
So the bottom line, Sherry, no, in this
and they're not sanctuaried on the other side. This sanctuary thing is working both ways. I think Pakistan has to take responsibility for years of bad policy making, and we need to do that. But now that there's a change, I think we need to work together and understand that sanctuaries are playing out on both sides.
A quick interjection from the minister as well, and then we go to the audience here. I've been patiently waiting to ask questions. Go ahead.
Extremely important to understand that you can't have it both ways. You can't accuse Pakistan of interference and then expect Pakistan to deliver peace in another sovereign country right next to our borders. That's first understanding. Second is, of course, that there are also issues from the Pakistani side that need to be heard. If they are talking about insurgents seeking refuge on other side of the border, then it would have probably be a much bigger and larger discussion, because it will take place on both sides of the border. And that's why I would rather focus on what Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif and President Ashraf Ghani agreed upon, which was that we will not allow each other's soil to be used for terrorism on the other country. That's the baseline. That's the chain. That's the foundation on which we need to build the change.
Correct.
Otherwise, we will always be caught in this retributive mode instead of looking to the future mode. Because the future is there, Talat, and it's very important to also give a picture to our people and the students who are sitting in Islamabad and Kabul that a shared prosperity awaits us if we are able to resolve this now.
The new generation, to speak to the new generation on the other side, but if you want to ask the panelists, you're most welcome. Go ahead, sir. Identify yourself and then ask the question.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Saif Ali Hassan. I am from Beria University, Islamabad. My question is simple, that if Afghanistan is serious in getting rid of extremism from the region, then why don't they start a serious major offensive against Mullah Fazlullah, who is hiding inside Afghanistan? And Pakistani people have already sacrificed a lot. What else they want from us?
All right. Any other question? Go ahead. The lady in the corner, G.
I'm from Beria University. My name is Faiza Zafar. And I want to ask this. from basically, I want to ask it from my own country, that why are Afghanis allowed to stay here in Pakistan without any identification? I'm sorry to say, because these were the pioneers of narcotics, these were the pioneers of smuggling, these were the pioneers for so many illegal means. Why are they allowed to sit here?
Refugees is a humanitarian issue always. We need to discuss the repatriation issue with dignity and respect for our neighbor. And let's keep that conversation. I understand your anger, but I believe that they have agreed to repatriate with the United Nations Human Rights Commission, UNHCR, over 1.6 or 1.4 million over the next year. We have 1.6 already in the country, and many more in my city, which is Karachi.
Let's go to Kabul for response to the question about Fazlullah.
Right. Are we also part of the problem? Why there are anti-Pakistani terrorists in our soil and we do nothing about them?
I think the element of Fazlullah and other elements that are basically operating in these lawless and uncontrolled areas is a shared problem. I don't acknowledge, and I don't know for sure, I'm no longer in the government, that he is in Afghanistan or in Pakistan, but that's, in a way, it's irrelevant, because as long as we tolerate this threat, which they may have different branches, but they are in essence one and the same, these things will affect both countries. This has been really our position for many, many years. Now, the second thing I would say is that on that one as well, accepting the criticism of many of his own fellow Afghans, President Ghani has taken a big, a courageous step. He ordered, with our limited resources, while we were also engaged in a big battle against the Taliban in Helmand, in Sangin, he ordered the operations in Kunar. Just within weeks of the attack in Peshawar, the people who were responsible for the Peshawar attack were arrested.
Three of them.
And imagine, I mean, we are doing this with our very, very limited means. The United States and NATO are no longer in the capacity of actually helping us operationally. They have taken the back seat. So we are doing that with our own Afghan means. This has to mean something. Going back to what the point that was earlier made about us being, or some of us being, just behind times, I think what's really the situation is that we together, all of us in this region, are behind time. The world is changing fast. New threats are coming up. And it's actually really a big shame for us Afghans and Pakistanis to be really talking about a very, very basic necessity that should be resolved between us, and that is whether terrorism is a friend or an enemy, or whether we should fight against it. This should have been resolved.
All right. Would you like to make a quick intervention before I take a break?
I have categorized and I have seen three kind of expectation and concern coming from Pakistan. The first category of Pakistanis concern and expectation from Afghanistan is Pakistan's legitimate concern. Of course, it is important that Afghanistan soil is not used against the national security of Pakistan.
All right.
This is a Pakistan legitimate concern. The second category of Pakistan's concern is Pakistan paranoia. And that paranoia is that they still believe that Indians are beyond every Afghan policy, that India has over 14 consulate general in different parts of Afghanistan, and our intelligence organization are helping Mullah Fazlullah. It is mainly a state of paranoia, and again, we have to recognize those paranoia exists in Pakistan. We have to address those paranoia. The third objective of Pakistan is Pakistan's hegemonic objective from Afghanistan, and the Pakistan's refusal to recognize Afghanistan as independent and sovereign. So we will never ever accept Pakistan's hegemonic objective from Kabul, but we are responsible to address Pakistan's legitimate and also Pakistan paranoia about Afghanistan.
All right. Time for a quick break, and then the Pakistan will begin the show to address some of the opportunities that we have, that how we can accelerate cooperation.
Welcome back to the last part of the show. This has been an amazing discussion. Of course, lots of things have come out, and as is the case with deep misperceptions and perceptions and the paranoia, the word was used as well. The discussion at least has stayed on this course that we need to look towards the future. So this part of the program, short as it may be, talks about the future. Can we identify within this vast reservoir of mistrust, those areas where we need to build on and build on quickly? So I will ask my panelists to briefly identify those areas, take one or two questions, and then go to Kabul for them to respond and contribute, and then conclude the show there. Go ahead, sir.
First, I want to repeat that the people of Pakistan, represented by their elected representative, have made a determination to respect Afghanistan as a sovereign country and to respect that sovereignty. But we also expect the same from Afghanistan. So that should be very clear. To make the point again, the one point for the future is that we have a joint struggle against violent extremism. Instead of blaming each other, we say we are joined together in this fight against violent extremism, and we fight it on both sides of the border, number one. And number two, of course, with the joint fight against terrorism is the push for a shared prosperity. So when, yes, there is a list that, you know, these are the steps Pakistan needs to take on its side, even in terms of, transit trade, there is also a list that Afghanistan needs to do on its side to facilitate Pakistan's trade to Central Asia. So that's where reciprocity and mutual respect comes in, that we respect each other, we negotiate, we deliver, and we keep moving forward.
Let's, as the minister suggests, construct benchmarks of achievable mutual goals that we can deliver on within timelines. And time is the new currency of any success. It's the new money at any rate. There is anxiety from Pakistan. Let me be very clear. There is a neuralgia about Afghanistan not managing to retain its fragile gains. We don't want the gains Afghanistan has made in 13 years. We have to level up this conversation to the future. We don't want those gains reversed. Whoever made them, NATO, the Afghan people together constructing something important. We don't want those gains reversed. We don't want for you to be in a position where you can't talk with us and fight with us as identified together against a common enemy. We have common enemies. And thirdly, I very quickly want to say we have engaged in a historic battle at home. So we really don't want to move. We don't want to be sitting with huge forces at our border. And we are literally in a position of, for once, our political leaderships and our governments are speaking more wisely than the people, or some people. And I think that's an historic opportunity. That's where we should level up our engagement.
To be futuristic, where do you want Afghanistan and Pakistan to stand in 6 months' time in terms of economic cooperation, security cooperation, peace process, particularly focusing on the future? Mr. Omar, you first.
On the future, let me be clear on a few things. One, we definitely, there is no way that Afghanistan and Pakistan can sustain the current status quo. Something, a breakthrough has to happen at some point. Something has to happen so Afghanistan and Pakistan could both live peacefully. That nobody denies. Nobody is against peace.
Right.
What we are against is a peace at the cost of our freedom of conducting foreign policy, our freedom of women, our constitutional framework here in Afghanistan, all those concerns that we have. Mm-hmm. But nobody is against peace. Now, we want Pakistan in Afghanistan to work together to try to come to terms with the fact that this is the 21st century, these are two sovereign nations, nobody can harbor. Of course, you can claim to say that we are trying to facilitate negotiations and trying to tell us that you're doing something good. No, you're not trying to facilitate negotiations. You're actually, we're asking you to bring in the terrorists that you're hiding in your cities and hand them over to Afghanistan. That is
what
we're
want
asking
in the next
for.
6 months?
I don't think anything can happen in the next 6 months. The peace processes, as I don't claim to have read a lot of peace process documents and all that, but peace processes take longer time. Economic development takes a long time. Talking about CASA 1000, Intapi, and all other projects, I think these are going to take a long time. For the moment, we need a lack of engagement with the terrorists on the part of the Pakistani establishment that will do enough.
Thank you. Dr. Asif.
I think for rapprochement with Pakistan to be successful, that rapprochement has to be based on three principles. The first is the question of the principle of sustainability. Mm-hmm. And that means we have to have a long-term vision for it. The second, it has to be an inclusive rapprochement. The emphasis is that President Ghani is doing this or saying that should be saying that what our all Afghan political class or Afghan people are saying that here. So we should not personalize our bilateral relationship. And the third is it has to be a legitimate process. And the legitimate process, we have to recognize our legitimate interests. That is the foundation of a rapprochement between Afghanistan and Pakistan.
Minister, what do you wish to see in 6 months?
I think I tend to be more optimistic about the timing, certainly, because I think we've already, I mean, there was a point about how much time we've already lost. It's not that we've just begun the conversation. Mm-hmm. What we need to do is really to build on this, on what's been done. And really, in the next 6 months, I can see a transformation taking shape. We have a visionary government here. They have done a truly historic thing by starting this rapprochement and this new tone with Pakistan. I think we have a very, very full agenda as two neighbors, very full agenda to implement in the years to come. TAPI and CASA 1000 and economic prosperity is going to be just the beginning. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a long-term process. But what we need to do is, first things first, the key thing for Afghanistan, and it's become a stigma for us, this whole question of the Taliban. Mm-hmm. And I can see the delivery of the Taliban to the negotiating table very much practical, and it's already happening. I can see that in the next should happen in the next 2 weeks or so. What the Taliban practically don't have much to talk about. Also, let's remember that the Taliban has never had a political identity or movement. When they are forced by our friends in Pakistan to actually come to the table. This is going to conclude within a few weeks after that. And what we then have to do is, as two neighbors, recognize that the world is changing, that the region is changing, and we need to really come up with new milestone and benchmarks. But for now, the very, very key practical thing, and it was so many times mentioned by our esteemed panelist in Pakistan about what is deliverable. Deliverable is very, very practical. The Afghan government is asking, is that in the next few weeks, deliver Mullah Omar and the Taliban Shura to negotiating table and get this Taliban threat out of the way.
Okay. The golden key is apparently the peace process with the Taliban, which Pakistan can either facilitate or deliver, depending on Pakistan's willingness. But that's apparently the key for a greater relationship, you know, to talk about economy, then to talk about track two relationship, border management, and giving Pakistan an access to Central Asia. I think the quick expectation from Kabul and from this show from our end as a concluding remark is that Pakistan has to deliver on the peace process. Thank you so much. This was the end of show from Kabul. Back to Islamabad.
Thank you so very much, Lutfullah. It was sheer pleasure, and we translate pleasure in Urdu as Lutfun those who were. I hope that the future is not again boiled down to the one man, Mullah Omar. There are many locks to the future, and we need many keys for that. And the key is to stay positive, practical, and stay friendly. Again, thank you very much for being part of this show. Sheer delight. Allah Hafiz.
Thank you.